try, but I think you're dumb. Anyway, welcome back to the Primal Scream. I'm Matt.
And I'm Todd.
And today we have Chris Ellis with us. Chris Ellis from the Quarter Barrel.
Very excited to have you back, man.
Indeed.
Thank you, sir, for coming back.
Yeah, I'm excited to be back. I had a great time last time.
There was...
We didn't even break out our Quarter Barrel glasses. We didn't even wear our Quarter Barrel t-shirts.
I looked for my Quarter Barrel t-shirt because, sir, you did a very sweet thing. You dropped off a little care package to my house one day. It had shirts. It had glasses.
Mm-hmm. I was going to bring beer today to fill those glasses with, so it's just as well you don't have the glasses because I don't have the beer.
Which is hard for a brewery.
So you are brewing your own beer.
Yeah. Been off to a slow start because there's been a lot more administrative stuff to tackle than... I guess not than I expected, but than I hoped. So I've got two beers of my own on tap right now out of the 24 lines that we've got. One of which, when the keg that's on blows, I'm gonna pull it and blend it out because I'm not that keen on it. But then I've got two more that are brewed and in tanks, about ready to be kegged. But yeah, I thought I'd be 8 or 10 beers in by now. But instead of brewing twice a week, I've been brewing twice a month.
Oh, wow.
That seems to be kind of par for the course for you. And you know what? Before we get into you, mm-hmm. delve deep, regurgitate everything that is Chris Ellis. Why would I say regurgitate?
That's not right. I don't know what you're doing most of the time anyway.
Regurgitate. So that's probably just... not something you want to link up with.
No.
With
especially with beer.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway. Yuck. Current events, everybody. Current events. This is what's going on in the world today.
Antonin Scalia. What are you going to say?
I was going to possibly bring up Scalia's death.
Uh-huh. What's funny is that the reason why I was excited about talking about this, not about somebody dying, but there are so many opinions about him because he is so polarizing when it comes to right and left that, you know, I heard from people that were like, oh, great, he's gone. Thank God he's dead. We can get him out of there.
Wow, that's harsh.
Yeah, yeah. Because he's kind of a dick. But he was also very
to your point of view.
Which is also very, most people thought he was a dick, but he was also very well liked for being very opinionated, but also being very funny, writing things and talking about things in kind of layman's terms, mm-hmm. you know, making them simple. So, I mean, I was one of those people that was like, oh, good, I'm glad he's gone because he's done 4 or 5 decisions that I thought were really shitty. Citizens United, you know, he was part of making sure Bush became president and stopped counting votes, things like that, where I was kind of like, what? Maybe we should have done a little bit more investigation first. But then I started hearing people like Ruth Ginsburg, they're like best friends. And she's like a lefty lady on the court, and they were buddies, and they hung out together. She loved him. So it just tells you that I don't know jack shit. And I don't know the insides of things and how things work. And so I like the fact that I was kind of caught off guard. I was like going, oh, good, what an asshole. You know. And then I was like, oh, wait a second. People who know more than I do are saying, whoa, 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 hold your jets, buddy. You know, kind of thing. So I like being checked once in a while like that.
Well, do you think that part of our passion about the Supreme Court, does anybody really truly give a fuck about it if it wasn't a life term? Would people really care that much? I mean, the Supreme Court rules on something, and we're like, oh, well, fuck, it's in stone because that person's there until they die. So the appointment of a Supreme Court justice is a big fucking deal. And the Republicans,
the Republicans and the Democrats
are all, like you said, freaking out right now. And they're like, they both have good points. So the Republicans are saying, we've never elected a Supreme Court justice during an election year. That is correct.
And that,
you can't argue that point.
That's untrue, though.
And zip it, Mr. McZippy. And the Democrats are saying we've never gone more than a year without or short a Supreme Court justice. So we haven't waited longer than a year to appoint one. So both comments are actually true. But how is it going to work out? This year is a unique one where there's an election season and
everybody's trying to make their side look like they have the right the moral high ground for this. In my mind,
and it's going to be a huge did he point
die,
for the election.
Did he die when there's a sitting president? Awesome. That sitting president should pick the next person. If Bush was in there right now, they'd be clamoring to make sure that he got to pick that next person because they
absolutely
don't want. So in other words, let's take everything, all the politics out of it. Who's the sitting president? Awesome. It's Obama. You get to pick.
Well, again, it's awesome because that's
take all the politics out of it.
But I mean, awesome. I'd be the first person to say that if there was a Republican in office and somebody died, then he's a sitting person, so he should pick.
Well, yeah, you'd be depressed about it. You'd be like, oh,
but fuck. I still would say it's okay.
But the point of why I wanted to bring this up was because there wouldn't be so much goddamn drama about this appointment. It's going to take over the rest of the campaign trail until November. You're going to be talking about, they're going to be using this as talking points.
Unless he puts somebody in office, unless he puts somebody in that chair, it will be the talking point. You're right.
I think my forecast for today,
it's always super clear and sharp,
is going to be that they're going to be using this as a talking point. If
no matter what he does,
if somebody gets put into position, the Republicans are going to be talking about it, right? And they're going to be arguing about it. It's going to be an arguing point when they're campaigning.
Yes,
I just think that's going to be the case.
Who stands to get the most leverage out of Scalia death talking points?
Well, if Obama puts a Democrat in there or a left leaning person, it'll change the court for the next 20, 30 years. And it's been a conservative court for almost 50 now because it's been 5-4 conservative, even though things haven't always gone that way, which is what makes a good Supreme Court, but it's been 5-4 conservative leaning. And so they're worried that if he puts somebody in there, it'll be 5-4 liberal leaning. So that's their biggest worry. That's why they're all just fucking clamoring and freaking out.
Right. But if it wasn't a life term,
right,
it wouldn't be that big a deal.
It's in the Constitution, buddy. It's a done deal.
It's in the Constitution. It's a life term.
Yes.
Maybe
they should just appoint like some really old people, so like a life term doesn't seem like that big of a deal.
Well, then
when everybody was dying off at 45,
you're absolutely right. That's why they tend to be older. So they really are only in there 20 at worst 30 years at the longest 30 years, because they should be a seasoned human being. They should have been a lawyer. They should have had a good background. They should have good appellate court. They should have a long road going up into becoming a Supreme Court. They're not going to throw some 35-year-old in there who's fresh out of law school or been on the, you know, been behind the prosecutor's desk for a while. They're going to put somebody in there who's older.
Right.
Usually they tend to be 60-ish years old.
Sure, but that doesn't mean that they get put there because they're old and will die soon. They're not put there necessarily because what they're saying makes the most sense.
No,
because
that's absolutely
some
untrue.
Of these judge, huh?
They pick people because of their good judicial prowess. I got some good words tonight. And
yeah,
I think
but
part
the
of that
things
is
that they've said, the statements that these Supreme Court justices have made
because
are
they're
fucking ridiculous.
Because they lean one way or the other, conservative or liberal. They kind of lean those directions.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean you make stupid comments.
Well, Scalia had lots of comments that you might deem as being stupid, but he was a very well thought of judicial mind, whether you like him or not.
Well, and so many of the, I say that as if I could name one or cite one example, but it seems like a lot of the stupid sounding quips that I've heard from him are more sort of examples of, I can't think of. I am lacking the words that you have tonight.
well, no, usually it's me that, who's lacking, so
I'll rub my
off
vocabulary.
On you. No, I think what you're saying is that some of the quirks and things you've heard from him have been the things that people like. His sense of humor, the way he approaches
things,
right?
Well, no. What I was getting at is like some of his decisions, like based on you know a strict interpretation of the Constitution or you know some sort of logical argument. You know, there might be this quip that says, "Yeah, this is an exception to the rule," and it's taken as like, "Hey, it's fine because that's what the law is." But I wish I could. There's one example that is totally perfect. What I'm trying to drive home, and I cannot think of it right now.
So there, what you're saying,
you're gonna
have
to Google it as soon as I get home.
there you go. You want to look? You want to try to look? I just typed in stupid Scalia quotes.
Stupid Scalia quotes.
And there was a lot of things. There's a lot of things that came up, and this was from the Washington
Post. Well, and the biggest one most recently is Citizens United. He was the deciding vote to say that a corporation is a person and they can buy free speech.
But you know what? That doesn't take the responsibility away from the other four fuckers that agreed with him. Oh. He was the one that said, okay, I'm the deciding vote. Yeah. But that doesn't mean that the other four, they're smart. Does it really, is that a person? Is money a person?
Is a corporation a person?
Yeah, but is money free speech? No, money is not free speech. A corporation is not a person. Come on. Why do we have to play
what it came down to is I'm Warren Buffett and I own, I forget the name of this company. That's horrible. And I own this company. And so I'm a multi-billionaire.
Yeah.
I can buy whatever ad time I want. So it's just one step off of that. I mean, I don't like it either, but to me, it's kind of like splitting hairs.
You know, my lawyer friend, who shall not be named.
But we're not going to name her?
No, she's she.
K-Dog?
K-Dog. Anyway, she would rather not be known by or recognized.
Good for her.
But
I don't like that either.
I would love to hear her opinion on it because she had some great points of view about gay marriage. For instance, marriage is a business contract. And through her verbal wizardry, she's like, you can make any contract. If you and I want to do a business contract, mm-hmm. we can. There's no law anywhere that says that I can't make a legal binding contract that says you're my mate. Period. So once you lay things out that way legally, it's a contract. It's a legal binding thing. It's a business decision. Let's take religion out of it for a second. There you go. Now we've just deflated all your fucking tires and there is no more room for argument. You know what I'm saying? So you'd have to go at it from a different angle if you wanted to. But whether it's legal or illegal, it's basically a contract that you're signing.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think the easiest way to solve it would, you know, there's always the split between, you know, marriage versus a civil union and why not just eliminate marriage as a legal thing? Just you'll have your civil union and then marriage as the religious thing. And, you know, they can exist together or separately. And that's that.
Yeah. Well, you know what? The whole.
Because marriage really is just. It's just the.
It's just a way for the ladies to get half my shit. Oh, I'm sorry. Whew.
I just got a little worked up. No, I was going to say, I think if you need to have a binding thing in the eyes of the government, then you sign the paper. You know, but if you want to have something religious wise, it's more of a commitment between you and that other person. So, I mean, I get that, you know, but unless I'm super religious and then I want, you know, I'm super religious and I'm gay. You know, I have talked about.
At times you seem like it.
No, I was going to say that. I know people who are hardcore Catholics, but they're gay men and they got married and they had to find that balance within themselves of going, okay, my church doesn't recognize this, but can I find a priest who's willing to help us out? Because I don't want my religion not to be involved. It's a huge part of my life. That'd be a hard, difficult thing to have to go through. I don't know.
What do you think about common law marriage? All we've been doing is sharing a room for the last 7 years fucking regularly. So now, just because I cohabitate with you, now I'm married to you through common law? Is that what it is, right? Mm-hmm. Common law?
10 years, yeah. You're right.
Isn't that like if you have a male has a male roommate for 10 years, you're common law married?
Are you fucking?
Common law isn't met. No, what's the difference between if you're a roommate with somebody or you're copulating, correct? Isn't that the diff?
Is that a nice word for sex?
Yeah, yeah. You never heard the word copulate before?
Don't know if it's a nice word for sex.
It's a bad word for sex.
Why don't you just say sex?
Bumping uglies? Is that
that's
better?
I think that's a bad term for sex.
Knocking the boots?
Making love.
Ew, you're gross when you say it like that. It was nice until you just said that.
It was nice until that.
Yeah, I enjoyed it right
but
up until that
point. I actually kind of think there's some friends of mine who are not married. They have two kids. They've been together for more than 10 years. Why would you? I think it's unjust for you, the government, to force this, well, you've been together for a while and you've been copulating. You're married.
Fuck you. I don't want to be married, because if I'm married, then I got to get divorced if I ever want to leave this lady. If I ever want out, why do you feel like you have to handcuff me to this person? And, you know,
and could you just lie and say, I haven't been copulating. We're just roommates. Could you do that?
Oh my God, that word is just driving
you
me.
You said it first. You just said it.
I said it in a jestful way because I was trying to
throw up. And so I'm going to say, so she and I are not together like that. We just are roommates.
You have kids.
Oh, if you have kids together. Oh, maybe, is that the deciding factor?
I don't know. I'm just saying.
We should call a lawyer.
Just the idea of somebody going, you know what? I'm going to make a decision for you. You're fucking legally bound to another person. No! We made the decision not to get married. We just live together. We share the bills. We're cohabitating in this space. I don't want her to be my wife. She does not want me to be her husband. Don't put that fucking label on us.
I'm trying to imagine a situation where somebody's beating on the door, like a government official. Like, we need your signature on this. You two are married. Like, you get a...
I wonder how does that shit come together? How do you get fucking labeled like that?
Is that actually a thing? I don't know. Is it?
Common law marriage?
Yeah.
I mean, it is.
I think it's a
people
thing.
People get stuck with it sometimes.
Is it
all
a federal
sudden,
thing or like state by state?
Actually, I think it's a state thing.
You know what? I think where it gets... the tomfuckery
gets muddled. I put a message out to our lawyer to see if she'll want to call in really quick and give us an opinion about Scalia.
Okay. I think it's when one of those people say, I'm out and I want out. And somebody in that partnership says, oh yeah, well you need to pay me child support or you need to pay me alimony. The fuck I do. We've been together more than 10 years. Yeah, I think it's when somebody gets fucking greedy. That's when they play the Trump card. That's when they say, well, we've been together so long and we have been fucking. I don't think the government like steps in. Wait a second, you too.
Every time the census is done, they're like, wait a second. Been together a solid 20 years. We need to do something about this. Get it in paper.
Yeah, because it makes you think that they're saying, okay, well, if you've been together this long, why aren't you married? And shouldn't you really get married? I mean, think about people who don't want to get married. I mean, or isn't like Kurt Russell and what's her face? They're not married, are they?
I think they just got married.
Kurt Russell and Goldie Hawn, but they've been together for like 30 or 40 years. 30 years,
they just
right?
Split up.
Oh, is that it?
I thought they just recently split up.
They haven't split up, but they,
I saw
you're right,
a
they
picture
just
on the cover of like Star magazine at a grocery store.
They just got married. That's true. But I mean, what's her daughter's name? Kate Hudson.
Yeah,
is her daughter. Well, she's grown up calling him Papa. I mean, since she was a little girl, that he's been part of her life.
Why wouldn't you call him Papa or Dad?
I'm just saying that they've been together long enough for her to refer to him as her dad.
But he's not biologically her dad.
No,
I forget.
He's not.
Oh, okay.
Nope.
Oh, I'm sorry. Not. Have you seen the most recent Kurt Russell movie?
What was that?
The one where he smashes the guitar?
No.
On Amazon, the old Western?
Yeah.
Is it good?
Bone job.
Was it dumb?
Bone.
I don't want to know the enunciation
bone
of it.
Is Tomahawk. It, that's the name of the movie. Bone
was
Tomahawk.
Was it good?
You have to watch it.
Bone
it's
Tomahawk?
Really, Bone Tomahawk. It's really pretty good.
I'm not watching
and at the end... I can't watch it again, is all I'm going to say.
It was good or bad?
No, it was really good. And it was good from a lot of different perspectives.
Oh,
Western.
You're so full
it's
of
a Western.
Shit. I'm not watching that movie now.
No. Honestly, it's a really good Western. I thought it was really pretty decent.
All right. Why do I feel like I'm being manipulated?
So it's just right after the very extremely graphic.
Oh, it's just violent?
Mm.
Okay. Could it be any worse than that? The Kingsman, where he murders 150 people in a church.
Oh,
that's the grossest thing I've ever seen in my life.
That was, I loved that movie, but there were scenes that, and elements of it were I was like, oh man, you're really trying to make me not like this movie.
Right.
What about the,
even the beginning,
what about
when
the ending where he goes back for the anal pleasure?
Yeah, that was another thing.
Like, do you really need to be like that overboard?
She's hot enough for straight vaginal. That's
no, I like that part. I appreciate that part a lot, but I'm kind of a butt guy. But I think that like in that beginning where that guy gets sliced in half, I think that's where I knew it was going to be rough. Because even though that wasn't very gross, it was just kind of, you know, subtle.
Yeah, how many times has that happened in a movie? Resident Evil, those lasers
never
that come
seen
through
it.
And blah, blah, blah.
Never seen it. So I was just saying that's so, I don't know, I was trying to be like Quentin Tarantino-ish, but super sharp and polished and, you know, I don't know. I don't know. It just kind of caught me off guard. I thought the story was good.
I pulled up Goldie Hawn and Kurt Russell and the big old Western facial hair came out.
Holy shit.
That's how he looked for that.
I liked him in Wyatt Earp. Or no, Tombstone, sorry.
Isn't
Tombstone,
that his look from Hateful Eight as well?
Was he in a Hateful Eight?
That was him.
I haven't seen that yet.
I was getting to with the smashing guitar.
I haven't seen it.
There's a scene where, I can't think of her name, the female lead is in the movie, is playing this beautiful song, playing a beautiful song on the guitar, and at some point Kurt Russell comes up and it's like, okay, we're done, grabs the guitar and smashes it. Well, the guitar she was playing was like a 150-some-year-old guitar on loan from the Martin Guitar Museum. And
In real life.
And the scene was supposed to be cut and a prop guitar put in, and that didn't happen.
And he smashed the real.
And in the movie, you can see her. God, I wish I could remember the name of the actress. But you can see her expression, and that's not acting. She's like...
Oh, wow. And I heard it's one of his best movies. People really liked this movie. Did you like it?
You know, I haven't seen the whole thing. I just watched
that one scene. Oh, wow.
Because I saw a news clip on it, and I was like, oh.
That reminds me of, this is not near as bad as that, but it reminds me when Prince was on Jimmy Fallon before he went to The Tonight Show.
Yeah.
And he saw, I forget the guitar player for The Roots, playing his guitar, and he's like, hey, can I use that in my performance? And the guy's like, you're a god, absolutely. And so it was a great performance by Prince, and he's just ringing this guitar out, and then he takes it over his head and goes, and chucks it, and goes, bam, on the ground. And then it was like a 1964 Stratocaster something or other, and he fucking broke it. And he didn't realize, you know, I don't know, can you be so artistic that you get into the moment where you forget that you're playing somebody else's guitar? Anyways, he took it and went and got it repaired and got it all fixed and felt horrible. But I wonder if in the moment, obviously he's acting, so he's just like trying to get in the character and do this thing. And then I don't know if I could survive that. That 150-year-old guitar.
Yeah.
That's old.
Yeah.
I mean, the United States was 50 years old when that guitar was made.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was just a mistake. Maybe the word didn't get to Kurt Russell. Like, hey, there's going to be a cut. We're going to swap these out. And he was just acting and smashed the guitar because he read the script and that's what it said in the script.
Oh, and some AD is over in the corner just slitting their wrists.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
I guess I'm the one. Oh, my God.
Yeah,
it's
Martin has made a policy that they are not lending anything from the museum again.
Oh, fuck that. Yeah, you're not kidding. Is this the right he made you?
I just received a... guitar.
He got that made for him.
It's a Kane original.
Dude, that's beautiful.
C-A-I-N, Kane original guitar made for me. You know what? People can say, I want a Gibson Les Paul. I want a Stratocaster. I want this. I want that. If you want to just spend the money, a lot of money for that name brand, that's cool. Awesome. You want something you know it's going to sound good. Mm-hmm. But anybody who makes a specific, like, there's no and other.
He built the rack that guitar's in.
Yeah.
So the guy built the guitar for him for the rack.
Yeah. So I built the guitar rack. Thanks.
You built the rack and built the guitar to.
You have a great rack.
Thanks, buddy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the guy right there. So.
Is he local?
Yeah. I work with him. I work with him and he does that on the side, builds guitars. He has some really sick designs.
I didn't know there were such talented luthiers in Cedar Rapids.
That's
a
good fucking word, Chris.
What I know. It's coming back. It's a beer and a half in. I'm starting to catch my vocabulary.
Luthier?
Is that the right word?
If it's not, it doesn't matter. It sounds fucking awesome.
You know what?
Luthier.
How do you spell that?
Is that a guitar maker?
Yeah.
It sounds Italian.
Yeah,
Luthier. He is a luthier.
something of a Latin origin.
I don't know. Maybe if you slur it enough, it sounds.
Luthier?
Luthier. That sounds like
maybe
a
it's
lute.
French.
Luthier. It does sound French. Hey, Google, Luthier. What's going on over there?
I'm looking up Luthier.
Luth.
Luth.
L-U-T-H-E-R.
I thought it was L-U-T-H-I-E-R.
I-E-R.
L-U-T-H-E-R-I-E. Is the making of a wooden stringed musical instrument.
God. A luthier. All right. Mr. Ellis is all over.
Beautiful. Beautiful use of the word, sir. Yeah, that's a Cain original. So
you're not going to lend that to Prince.
No. No.
Go ahead. He'll buy you a really incredible guitar, and then you have to get that one fixed.
The time, the effort, the craftsmanship of how to bring out those colors in that wood.
What wood is that?
I think it's a walnut. Yeah. No. It's a spotted. It's not a spotted owl. It's a
spotted cow beer case.
God. What? God damn it! What did he say it was? It's beautiful though. It's yeah. Fucking, it's
our really, lawyer really, said she's on her way to a piano lesson and she can't comment.
Yeah. He really like when he gets all the different pieces and he puts it together and he took a picture of every step and I thought, man, that first piece doesn't look anything like this last piece. And just, you know, all the different steps of just putting a real, really heavy black stain on it, letting it sit for 24 hours, wiping it off, sanding it down so that there's this three-dimensional wood mm-hmm. grain. Like, you look, when you're holding it, it looks like you're holding bark.
Yeah.
It is just fucking sick. So thank you, Mr. Kane. It's a beautiful piece of artwork.
That was. What is he? Do you care if I ask what he charged for if I wanted a guitar made? Do you know what it costs?
Depends. Don't. As long as you don't build, as long as he doesn't build you a ukulele, I'll tell you.
Huh? Because they're really expensive.
Because it's stupid.
Ukuleles are tiny? Stupid expensive. Or ukuleles are.
I just
stupid.
Don't want to see him. I don't want to see him play it, or I don't want to hear it being played.
I thought you were being like
nice,
and you were being a dick. How odd! Where did I let myself go to that place where I thought you were being nice?
All right, let me ask you this.
My bad.
Let me ask you this.
Yes, please.
Were you asking because you wanted a ukulele made?
I just said fucking guitar. I didn't say ukulele. I said, what's he charged to make a guitar?
Oh, okay. I don't know.
Did I say ukulele?
I don't know. What we had worked out was kind of a barter system.
I know. So I'm just saying, do you just know in general what he charges for a guitar?
I'll tell you after the podcast.
Great. I don't
maybe,
want
maybe
to.
Maybe you can get the in the know discount.
I doubt that's going to happen. You're just being poopy.
You know what? He might make you a ukulele.
Don't
I'm
be a
sorry.
Dick. Don't be an asshole.
No, I'm sorry.
No. I don't want a ukulele. I'm not talking about ukuleles. I'm just curious about guitars. I don't even know how to play guitar, so why would I want an electric guitar? But it's very neat to have something handmade for you.
You want a ukulele.
You look like you should play a ukulele.
Why does that is horrible. Why did you just say that?
He has the short sleeve button down shirt on. I can see him playing. All he needs is like a hipster hat.
I can't see
in a homebrewed beer, which you
can't see, but
has.
Under the table, I'm wearing a hula skirt.
That's exactly. When I think of ukulele, I think of a rotund Hawaiian man
playing it really high.
Yeah. Over the rainbow.
It could be any number of songs that are equally annoying.
I did hear some awesome Beatles songs that you can get for ukulele that were pretty neat. I thought that'd be kind of cool. And I do own a ukulele. That's why I don't need one.
You know what? Maybe a ukulele would be the perfect thing for me to purchase to take with me to my job so I can just sit
annoy the fuck out of everybody.
No, not play, but like practice strumming and finger movement, practice chords.
That sounds great. Please do that.
Major and minor.
Please do that and get back to us. Let us know.
Uh-huh. Pentatonic.
Get back to us about how many people hate your.
No, I wouldn't be playing it around people. I'm just saying because it's so small.
Yeah, some guy be walking around going, "What the fuck's that noise? Oh, it's Scala. She's in the shed somewhere playing his goddamn ukulele." That's what you'd hear.
I think I've made Todd crack. I think I've broken him.
I don't know where or in what context you work, but I think the perfect context for bringing a ukulele to work would be in some sort of cubicle farm where there'll just be the sound of ukulele and nobody knows where it's coming from.
You just see all these gophers?
Exactly.
It reminds me of that Far Side cartoon where there's a huge slew of penguins on the ice, and there's one penguin going, "Me, I gotta be me," trying to distinguish himself from everybody else. Sorry, that's just me.
It's all right. I'm going to give that one to you. All right, here's the other story, and then we're going to get into Quarter Barrel and your journey, sir.
My journey.
Your exhausting journey. Because we talked to you almost 2 years ago.
Yeah, it took a long time.
We don't need to get into therapy or anything. Right. But, you know.
Here's the other story, and you can check it out. Just Google it. Peyton Manning.
Yep.
Peyton motherfucking Manning.
You wonder how long it's going to take for them to try to hide things.
Todd,
try to
do me a favor. Break down the story for me. Right? Okay, so this happened in 1996.
Just in general, right? He was king shit at Tennessee. As
University
he should
of
be.
Tennessee.
He's an incredible football player. It's not just him. The Mannings have paid off this woman, I think, twice now in out-of-court settlements. The second time because they disparaged her in a book. They paid her off the first time that she got sexually assaulted by Peyton Manning, allegedly. They then talked disparagingly about her in a book, and she sued them for that, and they had to pay her off for that. And now it's coming out again of her. I don't think necessarily she's doing anything now, but I think it's coming into the public's eye that he was sexually assaulted her. And not just that, it's not just Peyton Manning, but that University of Tennessee.
But that's not all.
They're saying that the University of Tennessee, that I think that either she's suing or a group of women are suing, saying that the University of Tennessee athletic department, it became like a culture of sexual assault, like just covering it up and covering it up and covering it up for athletes. So that's the bigger thing I took away from it. I think it's terrible if Peyton Manning is involved in that. I think it's horrible. But the idea that the college athletic department, because it's football and everybody loves football, and Tennessee is a big, humongous college, that allegedly they were, you know, just putting everything under the rug.
Right. She was the lady that Todd is talking about is Jamie Whited. And she lists 27 specific examples of sexual harassment and discrimination she claimed to have experienced while working for Tennessee's athletic department.
So it's nothing to do with sexual assault by Peyton Manning, that I'm wrong.
It was accusation number 27.
Oh.
That lives on, though.
Okay.
An unnamed athlete, later identified as Peyton Manning, pulled his pants down, exposed himself to me, and as I was bent over examining his foot after asking me several questions. Despite the above preferred complaints, her filing said no effective remedial action has been taken.
Okay, so I mean, that's still very inappropriate of him to do if that's allegedly what happened, but he didn't rape her. Thank God. Yeah.
Well, let me ask you, have you ever done anything stupid, Todd?
Yeah, plenty of things that are stupid.
Should those stupid things be magnified because who you are now later on in life?
The stupid things you do, especially when you're like 19, 20, 21.
Yeah. I'm not saying a free pass should be given to everybody, sure. But I did some really stupid shit.
Yeah, me too.
When I was young. Very stupid things.
That's a really fair question to ask.
But if I become president, my stupid shit, which is just as equally as bad as your stupid shit, I don't know, Chris, maybe he never did stupid shit. I know he has. But now, because I'm president, my stupid shit is worse by a magnitude of 10.
Let me say this.
Because
I understand what you're talking about when it comes to this association, but I would want to know, and this may be extremely unfair, I would want to know if somebody who I was going to promote or possibly put into office of the highest office of the world, so to speak, was as stupid as me when he was a kid. I may not vote for him and hire him. As unfair as that may be, I'm just saying that.
Really, You wouldn't vote for you?
No,
I wouldn't vote for me either. No. That's what I'm saying, is that I'm going to hold somebody who's going to be president of the United States to a higher level, and I would want to know about those things, because that tells me that maybe he's just like everybody else and he makes dumb choices, but I may hold him to a little bit higher level than that. Whereas if I'm just an athlete, who's doing really well now, and we're trying to bring that into the limelight because they're popular and they just won the Super Bowl and this stuff's coming up right now. I get what you're saying for that too, that not hold somebody accountable now for their actions. Presidency comparison, I don't get it because I think...
See, I go the other way for the presidency comparison because if somebody were to say, yep, I had sex in public. Oh, so did I. But I know that that was a mess up. I know that I shouldn't have done that. Right? I've learned from those things. We're all the same. We've all had screw-ups. I can identify with who you are.
Sure.
If you can't identify with who I am because maybe my parents were uber rich, maybe I'm a son of a former congressman, and that's just my life, and everything's been covered up. Everybody fucks up. Everybody does. It's just that those people, their stupid little shitty things are expected to never have happened. Which is ridiculous. That's why everybody tries to cover shit up instead of somebody on the campaign trail going, yes, I did smoke marijuana. Raise your hand if you didn't smoke marijuana in college. Right. Anybody? Nobody? Maybe 10%? Don't fucking crucify me for that shit. But I've grown from then. I've held offices. I've done certain jobs. I'm a more well-rounded person than I was back then.
Right.
Well, I think, you know, sex in public and smoking pot are one thing, but and I have not followed this Peyton Manning thing. Wasn't it something like he sat on her face or something? Is that what I read somewhere?
I think she was working on his foot. He dropped his trowel and like pistol whipped her with his cock.
Oh,
are you serious?
That's a little different. I would think. I would think that. I mean that.
There's a lot of a sexual there's a lot there. Of icebreakers out there, yeah. Chris. That's no. Just a little bit.
What you're saying is
more aggressive. Can you look at my foot?
Like I said, it's inappropriate and it's extremely, you know, worrisome for me personally as an individual or a human being. But is it? It's not. I mean, that's why I think of the idea of sexual assault. I mean, I think of raping somebody. That's a very big altercation to ask to assert to somebody. And so that's why I kind of am like, yes, it's inappropriate. I think it's terrible. She has to go through that. Absolutely not. It's the worst. But he didn't rape her. That's kind of a big... I can't see that as a big deal. Is that not...
It's a big difference.
Yeah. So I just don't like the idea that they're talking about sexual assault in
I
this
also
way.
Don't like the fact I'm that when somebody says they're on the sex offender list, I instantly go, you're never welcome in my home. Right? But you could have done...
19-year-old dating a 17-year-old or
something. Yes, you could have.
Exactly.
Or...
No, you're
you
right.
You could have been fucked up and you took a piss and a bus drives by. Or, I mean, something just has there. I think there's absolutely levels to the evil.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There's this level, which is I was drunk and stupid. It'll never happen again. And there's the I fuck little kids. I mean, that's the extreme, horrible.
Right.
Right.
But even exposing yourself to little kids, as horrible as that would sure. be, is not fucking little kids. I mean, right. It's a big difference.
Right. But if you do any of this stuff, and there's a lot of little things that I wouldn't have thought would be thrown on the sex offender list for, but if you do them and you get on that list, your life is forever changed. Why am I arguing to defend sex offenders right now?
No, you're arguing to show that there is... subtleties that you can't just blatantly
right just like yeah. sexual harassment you can't come out and say, you know, make a case almost as if he raped me. He didn't. He did something stupid. Maybe he pistol whipped you with his cock. If I had one large enough to do that with, I might laugh about it later, like, yeah, I did that, it was dumb, but I don't
apologize.
So maybe an apology. I don't know. I don't If it wasn't rape, if it was just an act of immaturity and stupidity,
right?
20 years later, it really makes me question why are we even talking about it? It happened 20 years ago. I don't want my shit brought up from 20 years ago.
Well, especially if it's been talked about, like she got paid off, then they wrote a book about her, they paid her off again. I mean, it's a documented fact that they have paid her off right. twice now. So okay. Obviously there's something there.
She's had her paid.
But I wonder, but I don't think this was, from what I've been told, it was not brought up by her. this is like investigative reporting kind of thing. I don't know why it's being brought up again. I don't think she's the one out there railing against it now that he's a quarterback.
So is this like an argument for a free market where if you are an asshole, Chris, I just won't go to your place. That's how I affect you for your actions. If the University of Tennessee promotes or covers up sexual harassment at this degree,
allegedly,
then ladies, don't go to that college.
Or I'm not saying my son there.
There you go. Or don't say, yeah. I'm just saying there's other ways to say, right, I don't agree with your policies. I don't agree with what you're doing. Right. We just won't go. Yeah. You won't get our money.
Well, and I think if he sexually harassed her, then
as an alternative
for
to what?
Too.
As an alternative, as opposed to like seeking to sue or looking for damages
Peyton
Manning.
But it'd be no, like saying, you know, me as an individual will not have my, you know, progeny go to this university is nothing. It's less than a drop in the bucket for the university. So, I mean, the only way to make any impact to say, hey, what you're doing is not acceptable is to take some sort of action other than a free market sort of response. Right. Okay. I would think.
Yeah. No, I get you. I get you.
That said, I'm reluctant to say anything about anything since I know nothing I've not read the news, and I'm very reluctant to be dismissive of anything that is a sexual assault allegation, regardless of how seemingly insignificant it may be.
That's why I don't like the fact that, I mean, talk about like Antonin Scalia. I mean, I keep going back to that in my head of going, I've heard from this point of view of how shitty he is. And then I when he dies, I hear from other people saying, wait a second, you may not have liked these things that have happened, but he did this, he did this, he was this way with his friends, he behaved this way, this is the kind of person he was. You may not have liked some of the choices he made or decisions he made, but overall, he's a good person. So it's just as easy as Ernie coming in here and saying, oh, hey, yeah, I hear you're a bleeding heart liberal, you know? And I'm sitting here going, what? Why would you say that about him? You know, it's because I've heard these things. You know, so I'm I said the same comment about Obama and George W. Bush. I now feel bad about some of the ways I thought about George W. Bush because I don't know what it's like to be in there and to watch how Obama's been attacked by things. It makes me take a step back and go, well, God, I don't like people treating Obama that way. I certainly should have treated George W. Bush that way because of my thinking. And so I think that we have to step back and realize the media really, 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 really plays this stuff up. Because I'm thinking sexual assault all day long. All day long today I'm thinking about he raped this girl.
Right.
And then he fucking covered it up. And that's not the case. It's just still extremely inappropriate that he, you know, rubbed his dick on somebody. But that being said, he didn't fuck her. And there's a big difference there. It's like saying, I took a piss in the bushes when a school bus went by and I raped children. There's a humongous difference between those two, but they're labeled the same way.
Right.
And that big broad brush drives me fucking nuts. Nuts, nuts, nuts. Hmm. I didn't mean to put nuts in there so many times. Sorry.
No, man, that's okay. You can talk about nuts. You know what we took away from the podcast from the last time you were in? Cards Against Humanity.
You don't do that anymore?
We haven't done it a while because there was enough.
Can I tell you why? This is the best story.
Get sued.
We had a wonderful guy that we've had on a few times.
Wonderful friend
of ours, and we played. It was the last time we played Cards Against Humanity because we had a great game. It was a lot of fun. We've had some great icebreakers with it, by the way. I'll tell you another story about that in a second with an older woman that we had in here that he some horrible things he did to me, and he called me at 5 o'clock in the morning after the podcast is done and goes, hey, can you just take out everything that we did for the Cards Against Humanity? I'm like, it's like 4 o'clock in the morning. Like he woke up in a sweat in the middle of the night. And I go, what? He goes, well, we talked about brown people. And I said, yeah, that was part of
it. Did he get the biggest, blackest dick card?
No, 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 no. He got a brown.
His card that he put in had said brown people.
And we all laughed and he won the hand. But then he called and goes, yeah, I have a new boss. And his name is
whatever,
Jose or something. right? And I go, oh, he's like, so I can't sleep. I was like, yes, we'll take care of that for you. That was one thing. But then he started stacking the deck so that
we had this wonderful
this wonderful little lady came in here. Her name is Lori Moritz. We love her. She does Sweet Raw Joy here in town. She's wonderful. And she gets Reverse Cowgirl, is one of her cards. And she's like, so what's that? And he's like, talk to your husband about that. He'll let you know.
He'll thank us later.
Yeah.
Is what I said.
And then because I'm the one reading the black card.
I would purposely put in like one of the worst things that somebody could say out loud.
I had to
submit it because I knew he would have to say it to her.
So in front of her, I had to say, and he was just fucking laughing. And I'm like, a face full of horse cum. And she just kind of looked at me and I thought, oh, this is not good. We can't keep doing this.
She actually had a great time. She had a very good time. Well, she seemed not bothered by it. But my level of enjoyment went through the roof seeing how uncomfortable he was.
What a fucker. God. I really started having a great time when I knew he was miserable. That's the best part of my day.
No, just knowing that you got him. I got my buddy. I got him. So, yeah.
Yeah,
I didn't
throw
think,
a buddy in there.
I didn't think it was that big a deal until we had a few more people. There's that fine line with a small business owner, an entrepreneur.
You were skating it.
And do skate it because you want to have a frank conversation. But that frankness always gets held back a little bit. And that Cards Against Humanity thing, you could say, well, it's a game they made me play. That's my out. They made me play it, right? Mm-hmm. I didn't have any other choices. I had to put brown people.
You didn't see the gun that was just off camera that made me do it. I didn't want to do it.
Right. Yeah, so there was enough people that were like, I just don't feel comfortable doing it, you know? So we're like, okay, we're going to have to break the ice maybe a different way. Let's just get you liquored up.
Was that the way?
Yeah.
You only brought one? Oh, no, there's another six-pack.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Did you need another beer, sir?
Yeah. All right. I do.
That's what's funny is that you not knowing or having an opinion about what's happening, what we talked about tonight, is just as good as me, because I'm making all the wrong opinions and assumptions because I'm being misinformed. Do you know what I mean? Uh-huh. So I'd rather not be informed. Like, I'd rather not know the ins and outs of things. Sorry, that's wrong. I'd rather not get my media handed to me like this because I feel like it's incorrect. And I'd rather not know anything than try to have an opinion off of somebody else's opinion. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yes.
Not trying to sound dumb, but...
I'm guilty of having some trusted sources that I source opinions from. Those have slimmed down a bit, honestly, since the Daily Show changed hands.
Oh, isn't that the truth? God damn it.
You got a lot of your news. Isn't that fucking crazy? You got a lot of your news and opinions from Jon Stewart.
And not just that, well-informed. They talked about how well-informed people were. Not that you got your opinions that way. You fucking knew shit from watching that show. Not just opinions. People Googled things. People researched things when they heard him talk about it.
Yeah.
That's an impactful thing.
I don't know if Google knew like that I was watching. Google might... If Google scares the shit out of me.
How powerful it is.
Because there will be times that I'll type in two letters... And like a seven-word phrase that is what I was going to search for pops up. Like, you shouldn't know that. But maybe it's because it's the time slot of a show that a lot of people are watching, and Googling some certain current event things begins with those two letters. I don't know, but still, two letters should not, like, Google should not know me that well.
You know, it is
creepy.
Isn't that kind of a double-edged sword? Like, when I get on YouTube... Or when I get on Google or Amazon, it gives me the stuff that it thinks I want to see. But after spending so much time on YouTube, I want to please, for the love of God, show me something. Show me an area of interest that I'm not interested in. It's cool. You're being shown things that it thinks you're going to like. But when you're regurgitating the same shit over and over, it's just on this big wheel, and you're like, oh my God, I have found the end of the internet. It's now showing me shit that it showed me 6 months ago. It's just regurgitating shit. I want to see new stuff.
You really are on there a lot.
I am on there. Like, my job is just like.
What you should do is you should find like 10 blogs that you can really start to like. Like find a super lefty blog and then find a super conservative blog and find some things in the middle and try to generate some ideas and thoughts that way. First of all, it's going to take more time because you have to read everything. And then if you have a plethora of things you can choose from, mm-hmm. you can really start, you know, kind of assimilating your own thoughts about some of those things. Like I said, once Andrew Sullivan got off the internet, I just stopped reading blogs. Oh, he's done that too. He's been done for a couple of years now.
So John Stewart left. He left.
Andrew Sullivan left. Then I think Stephen Colbert and then John Stewart, right? Isn't that how
Well, yeah, but Stephen Colbert still.
Well, and like I said, I've said this plenty of times, Andrew Sullivan, to me, because he was a gay Catholic man who was Reagan Republican, conservative, but could generate all kinds of ideas and get you thinking about things. For me, it was huge because I'd be like, oh, fuck yeah, I agree with that. Oh, maybe I should kind of rethink some of my perspective about that one idea because he's pretty thoughtful about this. Maybe he's thoughtful about that too. And I might read it and go, oh no, I disagree with him. I think he's crazy.
Can you give me that bio again?
Whom?
Of him.
Andrew Sullivan?
Yeah, give me the bio again. He's a what?
He is a hardcore Catholic gay man who... Did I say something?
There was like five other things.
A Reagan Republican.
Reagan Republican. Yeah, kind of conservative guy.
Starship pilot.
I don't know what else. But
the reason I bring it up is some of what we talked about last time, which is, can't we just simply say, here's a fucking guy who has amazing points of view, and when you read what he's written, and when you listen to him talk, it makes you want to think. It makes you want to be engaged. Right. It makes you want to ask questions.
But dude, not everybody is like you. Maybe somebody. Maybe
it
somebody.
It kills me. Why do we have to say the gay guy had a great idea?
No. Maybe it's the gay guy.
Catholic. He's a gay Catholic Republican.
It's more that the Reagan Republican had a great idea from the perspective of a left leaning weirdo.
Or what if you have some fucking redneck somewhere who's like, I don't want to listen to these sons of bitches, you know, the goddamn fags, blah, blah, blah. And they go, hey, you want to listen to this guy? He's a Republican. Oh, goddamn, he's a Republican. I'll listen to him. And they start reading and going, oh, this is good stuff. This is incredible. Oh, he's gay? Oh, I thought they were just a bunch of, you know.
Why does that matter? It doesn't matter.
But
it
in
matters
our society,
to you because you keep bringing it up.
In society, that gentleman who has an issue with gay people realizes that the person that he's interacting with or reading about that he agrees with is also gay may give him pause next time he wants to meet some homophobic.
Every single time we make that a priority. Every single time that we talk about it and we make it a priority to label that person as gay, you know what? His words had a lot of weight, but they have more weight because he was gay. Or they have less weight because he was gay. Because we put his sexual preference of what he does behind his closed doors, it takes away from what we're trying to say, which is we shouldn't label people. We shouldn't give a fuck what their sexuality is. He's just a really smart guy with a great opinion, and you should watch or listen to him.
And if you want to live in this utopian society, I suggest you take heavy drugs and lay in a bed.
Yeah, but you want me to hug everybody. You want me to hug everybody. You want me to... You know, love on trees and be and be like one with nature and be caring and thoughtful, right? You want that ideological
society. Why do I
have to
have the label of hugging trees and caring and thoughtful
Listen,
at the same
do
time?
Do you want?
Is that like being
you
gay?
You want a utopian society?
No, I don't.
I think labels are important in contexts like this. Well, for the sake of context alone, because say, like, if I say factory farms are bad and I'm a vegetarian, then there's that context and I'm like, okay, I'm just playing the party line. But if I say factory farms are bad, but you know what? My dad's a farmer. I'm a meat and potatoes guy. Then you're like, well, maybe I'm going to give what you say some thought because you're not playing a party line. You're coming from a different perspective, yet you're coming right to a non-standard conclusion. You know, labels are bad, but they do give you some context for the message.
And I would agree with that, but I also would agree exactly with what you're saying, that I wish we didn't, that we maybe we shouldn't be bringing these things up at all. I agree with you. But well, maybe we just shouldn't. Because I'm thinking that the way he just said is kind of what I've been talking about. It's not that I want to tell you that I'm gay. It's more of like, I am a conservative person who has conservative ideas, but I'm also this. And so that if I have this huge problem with gay people, I might stop and go, okay, maybe I'm being fucking ignorant because I thought all gay people pranced around with fairies and scarves around their necks. And no, this guy is a conservative Republican who lives on the East Coast and does all this other stuff. So I'm going to give myself pause and go, well, wait a second, maybe I need to reevaluate this one idea. So that's why, I mean, I don't want to give you shit about the idea of a utopian society. But if it gives somebody pause and goes, okay, maybe I should reexamine myself because not all gay people are like this. And if this guy's conservative gay, maybe all gays aren't like this. Maybe I need to look at everybody differently because we're all just human beings. I don't know.
The reason why I'm just kicking this fucking dead horse last podcast, this podcast.
That's okay.
Is because you're continually told to be sensitive and caring about somebody else's perspective. We're continually regurgitating and coming up with new labels because the old labels are offensive.
Right. Triggers.
Midget. That at one point, midget was fine. And now midgets don't want to be called midgets. Now they want to be called short people. And now short people isn't good anymore because that label is offensive. So now we're going to change the label to something else. And then 5 years or 10 years later, that label doesn't work anymore because somebody is offended by it. So let's go with another label. It's not the word. It's the fact that we are labeling them. And if we can't get away from the labels, if we can't do that, like what you're saying, because it gives context to the story, if we can't get away from it, then maybe we should tell these people who are just like, hey, you're being really insensitive to that, the feelings of that person. Then maybe we should say, you should fuck off because this is the human existence and that's how we interact with one another.
It's funny you say that because I thought something similar the other day when I was listening to some news about Scalia dying and somebody was interviewed and it's like a man on the street sort of thing. And the individual is like, oh yeah, Scalia was... He was great for conservatism, or he was great for conservatives. I'm like, well... But as a, I mean, maybe we shouldn't have been targeting a particular demographic with our Supreme Court justice. Maybe we should have had.
Well, we hired him because he was conservative, though, right?
The greater good. Yeah.
We hired him because he was conservative. But you're right. I don't think that I don't know who put Scalia on the bench, to be honest, 30 years ago. So that was before Reagan. Was it,
you know,
Ford?
I'll Google it.
Carter. Anyways, Carter. Yeah, maybe Carter.
I doubt if it was Carter.
Oh, you're right. Good job. I think that you would hope that somebody puts somebody on the bench that is a good
Reagan.
Reagan. Okay. 30 years. Oh, I guess it's been.
Wow.
I'm old. You would hope somebody would put somebody on the bench because they are good at their job. But at the same time, we can definitely see if they have made decisions that lean more conservative or more Democrat or more liberal. I mean, that's obvious. So we're asking ourselves not to see people certain ways with labels, and yet we hire people for certain jobs under the guises of those labels.
Right.
You know?
Instead of just going, no, I really want to, when somebody goes, so you're going to vote for Hillary. Why would I vote for Hillary? Well, you're a Democrat. I'm not a Democrat. So you're going to vote for Trump. I didn't say I was going to vote for Trump either. Well, you're a Republican then. No. I just have ideas. And I just want to hear their ideas. And I just want to see how they're going to do it. Ideally, I think a president should say, what's the best for our nation? What's best for our nation? What does the mass of the people want?
But we don't hire people for that, though.
Can I just say what I want? That's what I want. I'm not saying it's a realistic expectation.
Oh, gotcha.
The fact that we have super delegates.
Oh, so even though Bernie won,
Sanders crushed Hillary Clinton, Hillary Clinton wins because they're super delegates who don't have to be swayed by anybody's votes. You know, I don't want that. I want, which we've all grown up thinking, that every vote matters. Please go out to the polls because your vote matters.
Not really.
Not really.
Yeah.
Not really. I don't want this to be a downer podcast, but
at some point,
that's the reality of it.
You see this stuff, and you're either going to make an opinion and say, I'm not down with that. I think it's horseshit. Maybe that idea gains traction. Maybe the idea of labels are never going away, so maybe we should fuck off with all our political correctness. Maybe there was an HR guy, my HR guy, had a meeting with us, and he goes, first and foremost, I'd like to address the memo that came out that we are no longer going to say the R word.
This one we beat to death, just FYI.
Yeah, and I said, what? The R, oh, we can't say retard anymore. Okay, what's next month going to be? Somewhere along the line, somebody's going to say, I'm offended. The idea, though, that I raised my hand and asked was, you have already said you want to create classes so that we can become more sensitive. Can we have classes to thicken people's skin?
At what point do we stop we're thick enough?
When I say something to you and you're not so fragile that your world is ruined because of my sentence to you.
Okay. But I mean, so if we don't use the R word, then do we draw the line at the N word?
To understand the context.
Right.
The context. So if a black rapper says the N word, does everybody get up and rally against it? No, because it's used in a context. It's coming from him. We're understanding the whole scheme. We're looking at the whole thing.
We're talking about history, and somebody uses the N-word because that's what they're called.
But if I'm saying it to a little black boy, and I'm yelling at him, and I'm calling him names, I'm trying to belittle him, no, we should not use the N-word. Absolutely not. But it's the context. But if you, and some people don't like this term, but if you pussify, if you weaken everybody because everybody's got to be super sensitive, then how do you deal with life as you get older? Chris, if you never dealt with any adversity and you decided to open a business.
Is this your segue?
It's a pretty awesome segue.
It's fucking horrible, but go right ahead.
But if you had never dealt with any adversity in your life.
Is the adversity in question idiots?
Yes, could be. How do you deal with adversity? Just in general, how do you deal with adversity? If you had never had any obstacles, if you had one of those
bulldozer parents
that just cleared the way for you, there was never any stress, nothing. Don't worry about it, little Chris. Sweet little Chris, don't worry about it. You participated. You get a gold medal. Good job, little Chris. If you never had to work for anything, all of a sudden you're an adult, you're married. You know what? I want to open up Quarter Barrel. Let's do this. And then wham, reality, life hits you. Do you think you would really be prepared to deal with any of this stuff?
You know, it's funny bringing that up because I've given it some thought. It's thought in more in the whimsical sort of wondering category, not of anything that I have any sort of anecdotal evidence for, but I wonder if, you know, I had to work for stuff as a kid. My parents did a good enough job of like presenting opportunity, but not handouts, you know? So there was always a path, but sometimes I needed to, you know, cut through some vines to get there. But I wonder if I see a lot of people out there. I come in contact with a lot of people that seem to have this sense of entitlement, and they oftentimes get what they expect because the path of least resistance for those around them is to say, oh, fine, you know, take it. And sometimes I wonder, like, if this work ethic is more just a martyr complex. It's like, I'll do the work because I was raised to do the work. When there are a lot of other people that are like, you know, come on,
get it done for me.
Yeah. This is what I am entitled to hand it over.
This is my expectation. Why aren't you following through with what I'm telling you to get done?
So even when I'm in situations where I'm like, I'm pretty sure that you're wrong and I'm right. I still like maybe give too much benefit of the doubt or give I allow too many cards to be played and you know maybe or maybe I'm lacking the proper metaphor here. Underplay my card, overplay my, I don't know. But anyway, like that the being raised to actually do work to achieve something is just training to do the work, not necessarily to achieve something, because there are plenty of people that are raised to achieve something without doing the work. I don't know. I don't have the anecdotes.
That's a good point.
I think that's an excellent point of view. I've never thought of it.
Gotten huge following on Facebook because of a video he did where I think he got an award, like the Nickelodeon Award or something like that. And I'll be curious if you ever get a chance to talk to him, by the way, because I want to see what he has to say, because his whole speech to these at a children's award show mm-hmm. was about the amount of energy that goes into doing a day's work. And being proud of that day's work and earning a living and not having things handed to you. And so I think there's like this, I don't know if there's like a need or there's recognition outside out in society of a lot of people feeling like people are just expecting to get a lot of shit. And why are you not giving me what I need? And what's weird is that that's Junior's generation of, you know, I have these expectations and you need to deliver them for me.
The entitlement.
But he's not like that. I haven't really seen any behavior from him like that. But his generation was definitely kind of like, hey, you know, I got an A. Well, I don't have a $10 bill. You know, I got all A's right now. So why have I not paid for that? You know, I mean, he's part of that generation. That's way – it's outside ours. I hate feeling like a curmudgeon old man. I hate it. I do. I don't like it at all. But there is a feeling of like – and I wonder if every generation goes through that, the generation behind them. You're just like going, oh, you little pussies. What the fuck? Go out and rake the yard. I'll give you $5.
When we played football, we had a piece of leather on our heads.
That's right. When I went to school, it was 5 miles uphill, you know?
What was that? I have no idea. Was that an Irish pirate?
I don't know, but it was kind of like this. I don't know what that is at all. Sorry, I have no idea.
That's kind of the fallback I would
generate. He tries really hard to do accents. A voice. And then
my ex-sister-in-law would always say, is that an Irish pirate? Like, no, that was not at all an Irish pirate, but thank you. Chris.
Yes.
To quarter barrel, sir. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about some shit. I'm going to hold your feet to the flames.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
Why actually. Did it take so long?
Boom. Yeah. There's the first question. Because the first time we had John a little over 2 years ago.
I was like, next week we're opening.
The idea.
And then it was like 2.5.
The idea week, was St. Patty's
it
Day.
It wasn't that soon.
Oh, is it? It was before St. Patty's Day.
Yeah.
The grand opening was we were going to do a live podcast on the St. Patty's Day float area route.
Yeah. And we went back and listened, didn't you?
And we were going to do a little celebration, maybe a little on location podcast at your place. What happened, pal? Well, where'd the wheels fall off?
There's so much that a lot of people have gotten an earful of, and I do have some reluctance to.
You don't have to name names.
Yeah.
Like certain, you can just be in general. Like we were doing this, and this happened.
Well, there were a few things at play, and I think it worked out to be sort of a perfect storm. On one hand, we decided to try to do a historic renovation of the building. And I don't know if when I was talking to you before, if that was a piece of it yet.
It was. You were trying to do a historic renovation, but was it necessary? Were you being held to that standard, or was that your own choosing?
That was my choosing. There was the opportunity to get some tax credits for, If I could go back in time, I would say, hey, don't worry about it. Just don't do that.
Really?
Because the money that we stand to get back in tax credits, which is not even guaranteed, there's still a lot of work left to be done paperwork wise and documentation wise. So it's not even a certain thing. Just the work that went into achieving the specifics of that historic renovation cost far beyond like what we stand to get back. Okay. So out of the deal, we have an incredible space. I mean, it's much more beautiful than what the initial plan
really
was. However, you know, we were close to we spent close to three times our original budget.
Really?
Yeah. And we're still trying to figure out how to pay for it. Fortunately, it's been pretty popular. So we've got some cash flow now, but it's not enough to pay all the bills that are stacking up and are a lot of which are a little bit delinquent. I'm tackling them day by day, trying to, you can stretch this out to 60 days. You know, I'll pay the 2% whatever, you know, fee, but I just need a little extra time. So that was part of it. Another part of it is that, and without going into the sort of detail that I like to go into, well, you'll see me get red in the face and a lot of words will come out. the company that I was working with, the contractor, there was a lot of flux. I started off with one individual, the guy that I signed the contract with, the guy that I talked through the project with for months before signing a contract with, the guy that knew the project. You know, I ended up signing the contract, and within the next few weeks, he had some sort of a break in relation with the financial backer of the company, and left. So, and with him left some of his team. So basically, the individual and the team that I thought would be working on the project, the ones that actually knew the project, the ones that actually sold me on the company, left, and they brought in another project manager, and it was new guys on the team. And just a group that I would not have felt comfortable signing the contract with.
Initially,
yeah, because we didn't jibe. Like, I'm not the greatest communicator, and to find somebody like the initial individual who like seemed to get where I was going, and I could like stumble over words, and he'd be like, "Oh, you want something like this?" And I'd be like, "That, yes." And then he was replaced by another guy who didn't really seem to have a handle on. I'm not your
form of communication.
My form of communication, that, and also he. As far as I could tell, had no experience in construction contracting at all, because I learned a heck of a lot through this whole project, and a lot of it, like, as I was learning, I'm like, why did this guy not do this? Like, I feel like I'm two steps ahead of the guy that I'm paying to be doing
this
job.
Why is the layperson questioning the expert?
Yeah. Eventually, then even he got kicked off the project. Another project manager moved in, and who at first was like a whipcracker, and I'm like, this guy is going to be great. But then he got put on other jobs, so like he may very well have had the skills and the experience to do the job, but was stretched out on other jobs. So it was just this mess. Things never got done on time. There'd be situations where, like, well, for the longest time, you know, March was our completion date. Right. And we're like, okay, well, then March sort of just kind of passed by. And we're like, okay, well, can we get I had some friends that were musicians that maybe wanted to do shows at the venue, and mm-hmm. like other people that wanted to do big events in May and June. So I talked to the project manager. I'm like, well, and, you know, will we be ready by the end of May so that I can schedule these June events? Okay, go ahead and schedule them. Then May and June went by and we weren't open. And then some of it culminated in like this really like butting of heads in a meeting in July or August, where everything was being put back on my shoulders about how I was screwing things up and I was making changes willy-nilly and blah, blah, blah. And then in the meeting, I'm like, well, first of all, like all of this information that you claim to have, like, is inaccurate. And I've got, you know, this stack of emails this high that says that this detail's wrong, this detail's wrong, this detail's wrong. And I'm not making changes willy-nilly. The city rejected the building plans and we had to make changes. Like the project manager was in the meeting with the architect. How is there any gap in communication here? Like, I did not change any layouts because, like, one day I woke up and thought, like, why don't we put this here? I had changed layouts because the city said, no, this doesn't work. And I met with them for weeks until we agreed on something that did work. And as far as I knew, there was no confusion about that, yet somehow, like, somehow everybody's mad because I'm making changes. Right?
It sounds like a lot of excuses.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. And, you know, the thing is, the owner of the company, I want to say he's a really great guy, you know? And while I have not always gotten along with his wife, who's the co-owner of the company, my wife thinks she's great. They get along great. But I don't understand. Like, so I don't want to diss them. I don't want to throw them under the bus other than to say that, like, the company as a company does not work, and it cost us a lot of time, and it cost us a lot of money.
Yeah, a lot of money.
Well,
time is money.
Yeah.
When you're expecting to open on March,
yeah,
and things are falling apart, and now it's
yeah,
year and a half, 2 years later.
And also, when this project doesn't get done, then that affects this project, and this can't get done until that project gets done. I mean, they kind of, I mean, that's what a project manager kind of does, to put things in order so that one thing can happen after another, so you hit your goals, right? Mm-hmm. I mean,
yeah.
And I'm not trying to rub salt in the wound when I bring this stuff up. Mm-hmm. I bring it up, though, because it is a reality to a small business owner, a brand new person who is trying to create something, whether it's flipping homes, whether it's creating a bar, a podcast, production company.
There are
unforeseen things that pop up, and you have to be
flexible,
and you have to be willing to accept the fact, all right, I planned on brewing my beer twice a week.
Yeah.
All right, that's what I would like. I'm going to play it on twice a month. Just because shit is going to happen.
Two a week.
Shit is going to happen. I would love to do twice a week, but I know shit's going to happen.
Yeah.
Does Quentin brew his beer twice a week?
Oh, more than that.
Really?
More often than that, yeah. But jeez, he's like a production facility. He's like he's in markets all over Iowa. I mean, I'm a different thing. I just want to serve my customers
at your location.
Yeah.
Which will in and of itself be kind of unique.
Yeah.
I'm brewing beer right here. I mean, if anything, you'd have like almost a zero footprint. You're not shipping it anywhere. You're not initially bottling it. It's going straight from the brewery right to the tap. I mean, that's one of my favorite beers to drink is Green Line 312.
Yeah.
We talked about that, you know, because it hasn't.
Of course, now.
It doesn't go anywhere, you know?
But it does now.
It does now. You're right. It does.
Like, I didn't know. I brought in cans of that, and I want to, because, I mean, we've got two of my beers on tap right now and, like, a lot of other beers right now. But I've got Green Line at the Quarter Barrel. And part of me, like, I'm just, I can't do this. I can't have this because it's off its own brand. Its own brand was, like, we're a Chicago, like, the Goose Island beer that's only available in Chicago. And, like, why do I have it here? I shouldn't have it here. I feel wrong having it here.
That's a good point, because how can they call it Green Line then? Are they doing something else to offset the carbon footprint?
You know, I think they've expanded the brand, and like what you can get here is brewed in either a Colorado facility or their Baldwinsville facility, maybe. And the Green Line in Chicago is still only draft and only brewed in Chicago. I think that's what I heard.
Okay,
but
the idea of Green Line is produced somewhere else. It's just very popular, so they don't.
I think they're just like, hey, it's good branding. Let's use this.
That's disingenuous.
You know,
I get it totally.
Todd, for those listeners who don't understand what Green Line is, what is Green Line?
Okay, so Green Line is a beer that's brewed just in Chicago, just by 312. I was at the brewery one time having my first lamb burger, which was fantastic. And people were coming in kind of every 5-10 minutes and getting growlers filled of this tap that just had a wooden block on the tapper. And they had a Goose Island head on everything else that had the brand, the name of that beer on there. And I said, what's up with that? He's like, you want to try a sample? I'm like, sure. And it was like one of those clean, crisp, awesome beers. I thought, fuck, this is really, really good. Why is this so unique? You know, why does it not have a label? Yeah. And the guy's like, well, because it's only brewed here. It doesn't get bottled here. We don't take it anywhere. There's no carbon footprint. All the grain gets like fed to cattle, kind of like New Belgium does. They do all these things with this beer production that make it not have a carbon footprint. And so what Chris is saying is that, and that was to me a big selling point. I was like, fuck, every time I'm in Chicago, I'm going to grab two growlers of that. I will come to the southeast side of Chicago just to get that beer because I like the idea behind it and I like the beer itself. So that's what he's saying. Like, that's a big deal. I mean, that all those things right there are selling points for me. But now he can buy it in cans and sell it at his place. And that's the opposite of why I would go there and buy it. Does that make sense?
But it's still a good tasting beer.
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, no. Beer. No, you're right. It's a good tasting beer, and I would still buy it.
Buying the beer not because of the taste, but because of the ideology.
I love the beer. The beer tastes fantastic, but part of me likes to promote things that are
solid pale ale. I think dry hopped with the amarillos. It's got that ruby red grapefruit sort of like.
How does it compare to the Hugaden?
It's much better than Hugaden.
How does it compare?
Much better.
Yeah.
Totally different style of beer. Not seasoned with coriander and orange peel as Hoegaarden is.
Hoegaarden.
But yeah, just a
totally different beer.
Yeah,
totally.
Yeah, American pale ale. Northwest Pacific hops, Amarillo, which does have that ruby red grapefruit kind of flavor to it, and it's a little bit of wheat, so it's got like a little chewy texture, and it's a really nice pale ale. I like it a lot.
I'm just saying that part of the appeal for me of it was that whole, you know, green aspect, for lack of a better way of putting it.
The green aspect.
Yeah, I like
that. I am on your Facebook page right now. I wish I had my laptop plugged into the computer here.
My personal one?
Quarter Barrel.
Okay.
Facebook page. It's pretty neat. You have how many pinball machines?
Right now, I think 7, although today 2 are turned off. I didn't have time to really dive in and repair them.
Oh, he bought one of Chuck. He bought Chuck's pinball machine.
I got the Xenon in there.
Oh, yeah?
I like that. She moans so good. I love that game. good shot.
I had brought this up before, but do you feel like the games today, there's an aspect of old games, the tilt. Old games, like you were throwing your hips into the fucking thing. Yeah. Like you were being physical with this piece of machinery, so much so that they had to employ this thing that said tilt. Yeah. If you got too fucking physical, it would say, eh.
And I get it on pinballs, but even the arcade games have a tilt function. And I, like, who's playing like Miss Pac-Man so aggressively that you tilt the machine? And what does that even accomplish? I don't know, but like I've got a few machines that I've taped off like the tilt contact because I'm like, I don't want to deal with it.
I had some friends who are a little bit older than I am. They're in their late 50s, and they told me they went to the Quarter Barrel. I'm like, awesome! Did you like it? I just heard it's fantastic. They're like, yeah, it was kind of loud, and I go, did you not go to an arcade in the 80s? Did you not go into the full tilt over West Elm Mall or Aladdin's Castle or anything like that? Because it's a fucking loud place. You don't go there for the ambiance and the silence. Go to a library. Uh-huh. I said, this is not just an arcade. It's also a brewery and a bar. So I'm going to assume it's going to be as loud as a bar. And you add the arcade to on top of that, it's going to be fucking loud. You don't go there to have a conversation necessarily and get intimate with somebody. Though I'm sure at times you probably can.
Oh, yeah. It's never going to not be loud in there, but that is a concern that you know we've heard from people, but that we knew we were going to hear from people. Right. We've got brick walls, we've got steel beams and a concrete floor. We're gonna put up sound panels.
Have you been to Dave and Buster's? Dave and Buster's is the most obnoxious fucking place you can ever go to.
Yeah.
It is crazy in there. And it's 10 times louder, I'm going to assume, than your place. So, I mean, that's kind of
nuts. I don't know. I would imagine it's probably equally loud.
We had talked.
Trying to help you out here. Throw me a bone, Chris.
But we had talked about a video game that you were supposed to get.
Did we? Which one?
It was the one where
Space Ace.
Yes, it was Space
Ace. Or Dragon's Lair.
We talked about both those games.
Did you get one of them?
You forgot us, didn't you?
That's another story.
Oh, shit. Good or bad?
Well,
it's a story.
Depends.
Well, so there is a story behind. Did you try to get those? Or
yes, actually, I have a Space Ace. It doesn't work very well.
Oh, son of a bitch.
I was dealing with this this broker. I've worked with a few brokers to get games, and a lot off Craigslist and a lot off eBay, but a couple guys like in Illinois that repair games, refurbish games. So I've got a lot of great games that some look better than others, but they all play really well.
Awesome.
I guess I haven't gotten to all of them to make sure personally, but I haven't gotten a lot of complaints. I'll say that.
I'll make my rounds.
I was working with a broker to get just some really great titles, and this deal just turned to utter crap. First of all, I flew out to Pittsburgh to check out some games, and oh, thank you. I flew out to Pittsburgh, checked out these games, and like walked into the space, and I'm like, nope, this is a wasted trip. This is
shit.
But it was
all the way to Pittsburgh.
Yeah, and it was. Wow. I mean, because they sent me pictures, but it was like a, not close. You couldn't really tell. Like the quality of the games, all you could see was like, wow, a lot of games. So I went and it was at the lower level of this building that was, it must have been like 300 games in there. So I'm like, okay, great. And there was a list, he sent me a list of titles ahead of time. So I'm like, I'll go through, I'm bound to find like a solid number. Like, I don't want 300 games. I just want to get maybe 15 or 20, something I can keep in storage, get them, swap out games on the floor, flush out the selection, if there's room. And I walk into the space, and the family that owned them, they were so nice, so I didn't like
get pissed.
I didn't flip out on them, and they even took me out to eat this really awesome pizza place. I was like, I was in love with the family, but the games, I'm like, I can't buy any of these. So I go home, I talk to the broker, I'm like, listen, I need my deposit back. This is a mess. They're in a musty basement. Everything is like rotten, like wood that's falling apart. And there wasn't a cord available, but like, dollars to donuts, none of these games are going to work.
You killed yourself, plug it in.
Yeah. So the broker assures me, he's like, listen, we've got a tech, it's going to go out. It's going to clean up games for you. This is part of the price. Don't worry, we're all good. So I'm like, okay. So I pay him the rest of the money, which admittedly makes me the idiot, because my gut and my gut's gut and my gut's gut's gut was like, this is not going to end well.
Just screaming at you.
Yeah, but at the same time, I was like in with the deposit already. And
you like the family. The family were cool.
Yeah. But I finally, like, I think it was just before New Year's Eve, or maybe it's right after New Year's, whenever. I got a shipment of 12 games. And first of all, it wasn't all of the games I selected. And of the games, like of the 12 games on the truck, one worked.
Oh, shit.
And that one, which is Burger Time, we've got it on the floor. Like, the cabinet was just like in bad shape. As I was taking that out of my van, like chunks were breaking off. So I've got it like propped up on one side on a little piece of 1x4. But it plays great. But that was the one game. And in that lot was Space Ace, which also is supposed to have the disc and the board for Dragon's Lair, because it's the same. It's like, I guess, the same mechanics for it. It's supposed to, and I haven't checked to see if there's an extra disc or anything with it. I don't think there is. So I think that was an additional chunk of it that I got ripped off on. But all the rest of the games were just, I mean, like literally trash. Like, if you would walk into an arcade junkyard with like broken cabinets and like parts just falling off, this is what I pulled off the back of a truck.
You get fucked. I mean, you just did.
And what I paid for these games on average, what I paid for these games was individually more than the average price I've paid for all the other games on my floor, which includes the pinballs, which are, you know, really generally
expensive.
Yeah. So I paid a premium for a truck full of games that don't work. So that's
and there's no recourse for that at all.
We're still working on it, back and forth. The guy's hard. The broker is hard to reach. You know, we were supposed to talk to him a couple weeks ago, and we missed the day because
life,
business is crazy on some days, and yeah. So then we tried to get in touch with him the next day, and that didn't work. And we've been going back and forth like, you need to let us know a time where we can figure out what's going to happen. And what's going to happen had better be, you know, a truck to pick these up and a refund.
Right. Let me ask you a non-horrible story question.
Hmm? I'll find a horrible story.
No, I don't want you to. So if I were to come in, is it straight up quarter slots? Or do I have to come and get a card? It's a swipe thing? Or is it just how do you...
Tokens? Are they quarters? Yeah. Do you have a change machine?
Quarters. We've got a change machine up front next to an ATM that just dispenses $5 bills, so you don't have to worry about like having $20 worth of quarters. All the games are... Well, all the video games are a quarter. The pins are all 50 cents. There are a few games that are on free play. They're not all marked. So some of them people are still sticking quarters in. I'll take your quarters. Unless you're in the know and know that it's on free play, then you can play it for free.
Entrepreneurs. Yeah. They're so shifty.
But yeah. But for those watching the podcast, we'll not be in the know. Asteroids is on free play.
Oh, I like Asteroids.
Yeah. Elevator Action is on free play. I'm trying to think. There are a couple others that are not technically on free play, but there are hidden like buttons next to the coin slots that will give you credits just because I haven't.
Oh, nice. Do you have Donkey Kong?
I do have Donkey Kong.
Do you have Galaga?
I have Galaga.
Awesome. It looks like you have Mortal Kombat.
I'm happy with
those. Mortal Kombat 2, yeah.
Mortal Kombat 2, Miss Pac-Man.
Miss Pac-Man.
I'm trying to look at this other
photo. Oh, I was like Miss Pac-Man too.
Miss Pac-Man was always
my favorite. Do you have any sit-down games?
I don't. I don't.
I can set a beer. I can set a beer on a sit-down game. I can drink a lot more of it too if I'm sitting down there.
Yeah.
Yeah,
like that. We never figured out how to work them into the layout.
Oh,
at some point we would like to, and maybe even just replacing some of the tables in the dining area. But at first we were like, well, you know, for the dining area, maybe a cocktail arcade table might not be the best thing to eat dinner on.
Sure.
So.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
You'll figure it out as you go along. Yeah. Everything changes.
I dig your layout. So it's not just an arcade bar.
Shit, you're busy.
Yeah.
Oh, is there a crowded picture in there? Oh, yeah. I feel like
it should be 13 again.
Centipede in there. Let me give a little shout out to our kitchen. Our kitchen is killing it. Like, the food is incredible. Like, it doesn't seem like the kind of place you'd go for food. I mean, there are other barcades. I mean, there's like the BarCade in Brooklyn, which is kind of the first one I went to that my wife and I had the idea to do this, and then my sister took us to BarCade and we're like, this is actually a model that exists. Oh. Maybe we can do this someday. But then, you know, they're in Des Moines, there's the Up Down, which it's in a basement and smells like a basement, and it's always packed and people love it and it's great, but it's divey.
But people travel to go to place. I mean, people come from Cedar Rapids to go to that place in Des Moines to go to a stinky basement.
Yeah.
So I would hope that you'd be able to do the same thing here, right?
Wait, we're...
Who is that?
That is Dirk the Daring.
Yeah, that's from Dragon's Lair, right?
That was Halloween, like, probably 10 years ago.
Is that your wife?
Yeah.
Well, it should be if it's not his wife.
Well, I'm not going to presume anything.
If it's not my wife, don't broadcast that picture. No, but the pizza is I'm as much as a beer nerd and a bit of an arcade nerd as I am. I have always been I don't know if the word would be pizza snob or pizza nerd, but good pizza is something that I love, and our kitchen is doing it. Like, I think
awesome.
I personally, and this is not just like me being biased, this is me being just a fan of pizza. I think we have, if not the best pizza in town.
Get the fuck out of here.
Some of the best pizza.
Because you have.
We're at least in the top.
What are we talking about? Are we talking like Chicago style pizza? Are we talking thin crust pizza?
What are we talking?
We're
doing a bit of Neapolitan style, but it's not straight like pizza. It's not like straight cheese and meat toppings. Like we've got this blueberry barbecue, which I was hesitant to even try because I'm like, that doesn't sound good. And blueberry. It is my favorite thing on earth.
Blueberry
right now.
Barbecue.
Yeah.
The hell it's you say.
Killer.
Yeah. And see, we have Need Pizza, which opened up recently.
And I love
great
Need.
Pizza. They're great. Have great pizza. Yeah. You have Tommaso's, classic, fantastic pizza parlor in Cedar Rapids. And then Zoe's in Marion. But Zoe's isn't quite as well known as Tommaso's. But
and Cappy's. I'm a big fan of Cappy's.
Cappy's is supposed, I haven't been there before, so I'm looking forward to trying them. But
Cappy's
I would have to try yours for sure. If you're making these kind of claims on pizza, I'm going to have to give it a shot. Because, I mean, if there's one thing I always, if people, you know, well, if you could only have one thing the rest of your life, what would it be? Hands down, it's pizza. I used to say like fried chicken and beer. Pizza is, I mean, pizza
I don't
is
know.
It.
I love fried chicken and beer. I love fried chicken, period.
I love fried chicken too. I love fried pizza. Yeah. It's got dairy. It's got your carbs. It has your meat.
You know what?
Are carbs in pizza? What?
I almost called bullshit on my 9-year-old son. I go, hey, bud, what do you want for dinner tonight? I go, you know what? I'm taking everybody out for pizza, right?
This is the one who hates pizza.
The one who hates pizza. I have a child who hates fucking pizza. So I don't know if he's trying to be just argumentative with me because I've also said, hey, we're going to Stone Cold.
I don't want ice cream.
Are you shitting me right now? What kid doesn't want ice cream?
Yeah.
Right now.
I'll have my share and his if he doesn't want it.
But I should have taken my wife for lunch at your place today.
You fucked up bad today.
I fucked up bad. We went to some other place. It was good, but.
And the last time we went to Need Pizza, I had 6, maybe 7 glasses of Blonde Fatale.
Yeah.
And wait a second. Where'd you get home? This?
And no, and I don't
Where'd
remember.
Where'd you get this?
I don't remember very
Where'd
much.
You get the Blonde Fatale?
At Need Pizza. You were there. He fell down on the way to the car.
Oh, well, there was
I
ice.
Felt, I,
let's not over-exaggerate. It was a fucking winter day in Iowa. I said to myself as I was falling to one's bottom, I'm really surprised I haven't fallen. It's fucking slick out here. I had my hands in my pockets, and the next thing I knew, I was looking up at my wife. That's when you know you've fallen hard.
Yeah.
My wife was standing next to me, and the next thing I know, I'm looking up at her.
And
okay. I totally misheard that. I thought you like blacked out. What I heard was I fell on the ice, and next thing I knew, I was hooking up with my wife. It's like you just blacked out and woke up naked in bed.
Dude,
what?
I would do that every night. if that's how the rest of you
winter.
I love winter.
My whole point of this was
I love passing
was
on
to
wake
think
up.
About. I didn't realize the Blonde Fatale had the alcohol level it had.
Oh yeah, it's close to 8%, right?
And so
yeah, it fucks you up.
I fell down on the way to my apartment.
And then you acted kind of the fool.
And then I got a little loopy after that. And that's, but it's been a long time since I've, but I mean, when you, that's what I think is going to be appealing or what I think is appealing about your place is when you find a very comfortable setting, you're really enjoying yourself. You kind of lose track of what you're doing, which is a good thing, I think, mostly, unless you're drinking too much Blonde Fatale. Mm-hmm. That's why I think it's going to be appealing because I think I like the way Need Pizza is kind of laid out. I like their pizza, obviously. And so I think that that's why we're lacking restaurants. We're lacking bars where it's not like just – it's not a bar scene, you know? I mean, I don't mind Hazard County, but I'm not going to try to spend time there if I don't have to, right? I mean, there's certain things. I mean, I think I'd much rather spend time at – Cobble Hill or Popoli or, you know, a restaurant where I can kind of really settle in and feel comfortable. And I think that's one appealing thing of a BarCade. And I can't wait to get in here. I cannot believe that we didn't even say business lunch. Why do you not go there? I mean, seriously, today I could have said, I'm going to go grab lunch and I'm going to go there. And I didn't do that. So,
would you be down ever with just us doing a live podcast, just audio from Quarter Barrel?
It might be loud as fuck. Would that be too loud?
Well,
ding, 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 blah, 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 blah,
it
ding,
could possibly be loud.
I cannot dial in the sound. Like I've adjusted the volume on Donkey Kong so many times, but I just cannot get it just right. Either it's you can't hear it when you're playing, or it's all you can hear in the room is.
It's one of those things that I don't think you're going to be able to fine tune it like that. Maybe if you like kill the power.
Maybe there's a time before 11, before you open,
or
a day, that you're not open that we can come in.
We're not open on Mondays right now.
Kind of hang out.
Try maybe, some of your beers.
Try some beers. Try Absolutely. Some. Try some pizza. We can have like a little sampler of different stuff. I can critique your shit.
Yeah.
Play rip some video games.
I'll critique your
I
shit.
I probably wouldn't rip it to shreds. I'd probably just be like,
he likes
really
he likes
good.
Little Caesars. I'll compare your stuff.
No.
Can I tell you? I like Little Caesars.
If you want to shit water, like if you want to shit water, enjoy your Little Caesars, guys.
For me,
you
know, like what? Pizza Hut is what always destroyed my stomach.
Me too.
If you have Same a thing. Nancy a Caesars, digestive system and you have to shit water,
I got a cow's gut. Are you kidding me? I can eat. I eat bad food out of my refrigerator, and then the next morning I feel just fine. Little Caesars and Pizza Hut both
allegedly
tear me. They tear me Allegedly. To shreds. My internal tract straightens out somehow, and it just goes right on out of there.
Dude, that happens to my wife. It doesn't matter where we eat. Well, it kind of does. But more often than not, we will go out to eat, and she'll say, get me the fuck home. Like right now, how is that humanly possible? How is that possible that you eat something, and within 20 minutes, we're done?
Well, I'll tell you what. Come to the Quarter Barrel. We have the nicest restrooms in town.
Hey, you know what? A good
God
restroom.
God bless you, sir. God yes. bless you.
It's one of the best parts about being here at the vault. I walk in that bathroom and I have my own door I can open up to go into the
yeah.
stall.
Like, I feel like at Jesus, any moment somebody's going to ask me if I want a mint.
Exactly.
There's your hand towel that he hands you with tongs, some. You know? Here's your warm hand towel, sir.
Cologne? What cologne do you like, sir? Yeah, exactly.
I should start doing that at the Quarter Barrel. Like, since not everybody like recognizes me as the owner. When I'm not doing like owner things,
did
like,
you just say you're gonna dick stalk?
No, I should hang out in the restroom and like give out mints. You know, I should be the attendant.
Thank you for coming.
Yes, where put on my
thank you for coming, sir.
Get some
thank
use out of my tux.
Here's a free quarter. Here's a free gameplay. Yeah, and you could use your tux.
Yeah.
I think you just need a T-shirt that says "fucking owner."
Yeah,
owner.
No, then people ask
and
you
bouncer
to do things.
On the back.
Like, can you? Oh. This game took my quarter. Oh, did you try pressing the start button? Oh, oh!
Isn't that funny? But these are people that are probably younger than
these
us.
These are situations that you probably thought I'm never going to have to fucking live through. I'm really never going to have to ever live through the idea, the fact, the situation where someone puts a quarter in and they never hit the start button.
Yeah.
The flashing green light. Yeah. Just hit the flashing green light, please.
Press start. Press start. Press start.
And so many, every day I've got to unjam like the coin acceptors that are just stuffed full of quarters because somebody puts in a quarter and it doesn't give them a credit for whatever reason. I don't know. Because a lot of these old acceptors expect older, heavier quarters with like less of a ridge. I don't know. I haven't replaced all of the coin acceptors with ones that accept, you know, quarters that are newer than 1982. But like,
how weird. I would have never thought about that.
Yeah. But every day, like there is at least one or two like coin acceptors. That's just jammed of quarters because somebody sticks a quarter and it doesn't go through. And instead of pressing the button that returns the quarter that it didn't accept,
yeah,
they just put another quarter in. And then all of a sudden they're like eight quarters squeezed into a spot that's meant to fit one. I'm like, ah,
Let me swear for you.
You dumb motherfuckers. No. Stop putting quarters in the window.
It's a re-education of our society.
Yes. I'm happy. And granted, you know, if $3 worth of quarters dump out when I do this, I'm like, I guess that's my pay for having to dig these out. But for their sake, like just press the button before you try the next quarter. Maybe.
Be a cool sign. You can antique a little sign that says, do me a favor. Press the button if the quarter doesn't go through.
All right.
Do me a favor. Don't be a dipshit.
Yeah, exactly.
I want to ask you a sensitive question.
Okay, good. Get me off the track of
I let you feel
for my customers.
I let you feel warm and fuzzy long enough.
Yes.
So I'm going to ask you a harder question, sir.
Yes.
Answer it if you will. But starting a business and the challenges that you went through, how has that challenged your home life? Because that is a fucking reality that a lot of people, they get obsessed with their business. They lose sight of what they have at home, the relationship, the communication, the expectation, the timeline, the money. How are you doing?
Because you were in it, buddy.
Yeah. Well, on one hand, I'll divide it into two parts. There's the wife and there's the kids. Divide it into three parts. There's the house. The house is utterly neglected. Sure. I feel like I live in squalor. I go home and I'm like, oh, I don't remember eating at home in the past week. Like, why do I have like 3 weeks worth of dishes piled in the sink? My wife, who's an attorney, does a lot of work from home, and working from home means working from the quarter barrel. So we're always together. Like, our relationship is great. What sucks is that there are so many instances where, like when Comic-Con was going on downtown, Laurel and I were going to take our
games
boys
down to Comic-Con.
Well, right? We weren't going to take games down this time. We were just going to go for ourselves. We were going to bring our kids.
Okay,
we had them dressed up like in their superhero outfits. We've got a boy that just turned one and a boy that's 2.5. So one of them was dressed like Spider-Man, the other one like Superman. And like, we're going to have just our first Saturday away from the business. We're going to, you know, go down to Comic-Con for a few hours. And we knew we would spend some time at the business. And we stopped by because we needed to drop off like the money for the drawers and whatnot. And we got there and we figured that there would be a post Comic-Con rush. But we did not anticipate a pre-Comic-Con rush. So we got there to drop off the money, and the place was just like blowing up like at 11 a.m. So we never made it down ourselves. We got to work. So it's tough. Like we it's hard to have – I don't want to make a habit of like missing engagements with my kids or like having plans with my kids and like, oh, daddy's got to work that involves like just like bussing tables and bar backing because the bar is slammed unexpectedly. And
that's a growing pain though. I don't see that happening all the time.
I know.
Eventually
we will get the staffing figured out, but still it's all too common of a thing that I get home and my 2.5-year-old who's getting more and more articulate every day is like, Oh, is daddy still at work? I'm like, no, I'm home. But that seems like the exception to the rule. Cause I always get like from my wife, like, oh, you know, Wesley asked where you are. And I was like, well, and then he cut me off. Oh, daddy at work. I'm like, yeah, daddy's at work.
Yeah. My kids say now, do you have a podcast tonight, Dad, or will you be home when I get off the bus? Dad's going to be at the studio. Oh, okay. But I'll be home later. Are you going to be drunk?
And see, me as a single parent, my kids are home right now. That's why I keep getting texts from my kids. They've been home for 2.5 hours by themselves. They got their homework done. They fed themselves.
There you go.
They're all, but still, is that
for a fact?
Yeah. Is that a good thing? You know, well, that my kids can my kids function for 2.5 hours by themselves? Absolutely, they're fine.
It kind of comes
but
back.
Is that
to
okay?
That,
you know, is that an okay thing for on a regular basis to be by themselves without their parent around?
Yes,
you know?
And no.
You're right. It's a double edged sword.
Yes and no.
On one hand, I don't know what the like social effects of me not being around as much as I would otherwise prefer to be around will be on them. Like if I'm going to be somewhat of a distant dad, I don't know what the effect is going to be on them or if it's all going to be fine because we do, you know, we still co-sleep. So like, no, wait,
did you say that?
It'll
we
be
co-sleep?
Fine.
We call yeah. Both. It's four of us in the bed. It's not ideal because I get all of 8 inches of a bed.
Yeah.
Brother.
Fuck that.
Brother, I feel like we just got so much closer.
You guys are both ridiculous.
I have to threaten the lives of my children. I have to say, okay, I'm about ready to lose my shit. Tonight, if anybody comes to our bed tonight. I mean, now they're 9, 10, 11.
They're fucking big kids.
So I have to say, still, to this day, I said it this morning. Hey, bud, woke up 3 times last night. Why? Because you were kicking me. You were fucking kicking me, pal. And we didn't invite you into bed. And what I want to say is, what if daddy really wanted to have sex with mommy? But yeah. I don't say that.
Yeah.
This could be a whole other podcast. We're running out of time.
Yeah.
But
Yeah, I wanted to.
My kids are fortunately very sound sleepers. I'll say that.
No balls, no kicked in the balls yet.
Wait a second. I think I know what you're alluding to. Yes,
that is what I'm alluding to. But a delightful
until
anecdote.
Until therapy kicks in. Yeah. These horrible noises.
You used to be such a sound sleeper.
It's funny. The other day, because one of our kids has not been weaned from, well, the young one, the one-year-old, has not been weaned yet from breastfeeding. And our two-and-a-half-year-old fell asleep on my side of the bed recently. So I flipped over to the opposite side of the bed that I usually sleep on.
All right.
So our one-year-old.
Somebody come looking for a nipple?
Yes. All night long.
I knew it.
Yes.
I knew it.
And aggressively.
Aggressively
like,
coming.
Like there's no booby. Like he was like pinching and grabbing and like slapping me in the face and like. No.
Are we going back? Are we segueing way?
Mommy is that way.
We're segueing back to Peyton Manning for some reason. Yes.
And now for just a split second, for one evening, you knew the pains of a mom.
Yeah.
You knew what it was like to be
there.
A lady.
I'm there. I'm so. That's why I'm so sensitive now.
Don't want your nipples to be hard. It's just too painful.
All right, Todd. Obviously, I wanted to. This is kind of breaking news. I kind of wanted to bring up Sean Penn. Maybe I'll do that next podcast.
Yeah, do it next podcast.
Did Sean Penn die?
No.
Oh,
but he got nailed for bringing HGH, human growth hormone, into fucking Mexico. When does that become a news story?
It
when
doesn't.
You're smuggling shit into Mexico.
Only because you fucking brought it up.
No, it becomes a news story because it's Sean Penn, but normally it's when you're bringing shit into the United States anyway. Yeah. Well, maybe we'll talk about it next time, but...
He's probably bulking up for some role.
Exactly.
Before you know it,
character
Mister,
actor.
And we'll let you know, we have another podcast that I'm associated with called Well Razor Radio. Which will be kicking off, and we're going to be interviewing celebrities. No shit. One of those celebrities who have already agreed to be on, one Sly Stallone.
Seriously?
Yes. And I'm going to ask him about HGH.
Is he coming to Cedar Rapids?
No. Via the camera.
The internets.
Via the internets. And we're going to be discussing some things
with him.
We live
in the future, don't we?
Yes,
that's
we
incredible.
Do.
Yeah, I can't wait to watch it.
Yeah, when there's a hologram of Sly, then I'll just be like, are you fucking kidding me? This is amazing. We are in Star Trek or Star Wars.
Well, I heard a podcast the other day that said, you realize Star Trek, they use walkie-talkies. It's not really that advanced.
Touche.
Touche.
Touche. Chris.
Yes.
Is there anything that's coming up for the Quarter Barrel, or is there anything that you want to say about the Quarter Barrel before we leave, before we sign off?
Oh, man. Well, I've already
put you on the spot.
I've already gone crazy about the pizza because I'm in love with our pizza.
Chicken wings? Got chicken wings?
You know, we're always hiring, and I'm looking for beer knowledgeable people because we've got some great service staff, and I just want to elevate the knowledge aspect because we're a brewery and want to have well curated not only beer but actually wine and whiskey as well, so I'll throw that out there. But you know it's a crazy thing that just trying to start a business that's a different kind of thing,
and it's Cedar Rapids.
Yeah,
we always forget that it's Cedar Rapids,
and I love and hate some of the response that we've gotten. Like sometimes like people like pull on my shirt sleeve and like, here's my complaint about your place. And sometimes it's legitimate. Sometimes it's like, oh, it's too noisy. And I'm like, okay, that is definitely on our radar. And it's something that we're working on. We're going to get sound panels, blah, blah, blah. Sometimes it's just crazy stuff. Like you really need like half of your menu to be gluten-free. I'm like, well, we're a brewery
and
we do mostly pizza, so I don't know how to deal with that. And it's not that we're unsensitive to that, and we've got like one gluten-reduced beer on tap and some ciders, but like, you know, you can't please everybody.
I was just going to say you're being very insensitive, but clearly you're not.
No, I think he's being way too nice.
Right. Yeah, but then the flip side, we get awesome response from people that we would not... Which makes a lot of times I feel bad because I'm like I will like peg people a certain way. I'm like you know this is not the place for you. And then they turn out to be like some of our favorite customers. Like like my wife and I were just at the bar, you know, eating some food ourselves, and we were on our computers because we were trying to get some work done. And a couple sat next to us, and I don't know if they knew that we were involved with the place or owned the place. But we heard him talking, and one guy like looked at the menu and was like, oh, you guys do fancy pizza here. And it kind of sounded like a negative tone. So like my wife went into a bit of damage control, and she's like, oh, well, you know, our kitchen's really accommodating. You know, we've got a cheese option, and we've got like a variety of meats and some other toppings. So, you know, while it's not on the menu, if there's something particular you want, you know, just let the server know, and the kitchen, you know, can put something together for you. And he's like, no. No, I want to try what's on your menu. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, cool. And then, you know, we heard him asking the bartender like about beer, like, well, what do you have for beer? You know, usually I drink Busch Light. She's like, oh, okay. Well, you know, we do have a variety of domestics in cans in the fridge. And he's like, well, you know, I'd like to try something on tap. Like, what's going to be the closest thing to that, you know, that you have on draft? And she directed him towards Boomtown, which is a cream ale from Big Grove from Solon.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And he loved it, and I think he had like three or four of them, you know. And it was like, wow, I love, you know, the customers that are so like this is what I want, and if you don't have it, I'm upset. And then, but to have interactions with customers that are like, this is not what I expected, but let me give it a shot, and then they turn out to like it.
That's
redeeming.
Yeah.
And that should be, I actually think that should be kind of like a sales point for your servers and your bartenders. This may not be your average Joe's brewery or restaurant or whatever, mm-hmm. but hey, we want to kind of challenge you. And, you know, if you like such and such, this is a good beer. You'd probably enjoy this one. Or if you like this, you'll probably like that. Knowing that it is Cedar Rapids and we have five Little Caesars, you know, I mean, so telling somebody, you know, hey, I'm glad you know, oh, that's awesome. I like Miller Lite too, but you know what? This is the one that we offer that I think you like. It has a little bit different taste or a different flavor, but I think you should give it a shot. Something kind of new and different. I think that's a good sales point for people to kind of say, hey, I know you like the basics, mm-hmm. but give it a shot.
You know? Do you have Canadian bacon sauerkraut?
Not yet, but we will.
If you ask, I heard if you ask a server, they can accommodate you and make what
you know
need.
What? So. I only bring that up because that's what my wife orders religiously.
Yeah.
But what was that blueberry thing that you said?
Oh, earlier? The blueberry barbecue?
The blueberry barbecue. I'm going to give that a shot.
Yeah, me too.
The very next time I'm off, which is going to be on Friday, and I'm going to be there at 11 a.m. because that's when I'm having lunch. Perfect. Friday. For everybody else, you can check out Quarter Barrel on Facebook.
Can we do noon? I can meet you there at noon, but I can't do 11.
I don't really want to spend time with you.
Okay, right.
Okay.
Sorry.
But anybody else, you can go to Quarter Barrel. Check them out on Facebook. Go to Quarter Barrel on Facebook. You can check out their hours. Look at all the different pictures. It has it on there. Tuesdays through Thursdays, 11 a.m. to 12 a.m. Fridays and Saturdays at 11 to 2 a.m. Ooh, night owls. And Sunday, 11 a.m. to 10 p.m. And they're closed on Mondays. So
for the time being, we're thinking Monday, my wife and I were working in the space, and we saw so many people like just walk up to the front door and then see the hours and walk away disappointed.
Sad.
We're like, maybe.
Sad face.
Yeah, maybe we should be open on Monday. I think we could have some business on Monday. Probably better business on Monday than Tuesday.
We have a few bills that we need to pay off.
Yeah, exactly.
Monday it is. But yeah, check out their hours on that. And then also look for their website, because now we're going to shame Chris into getting his website posted.
I
go to quarterbarrel.com.
Thequarterbarrel.com.
Thequarterbarrel.com.
Like the Ohio State.
Don't forget the. At
thequarterbarrel.com.
So check them out there. And Chris will get it done. And he'll have an updated menu. And he's going to work a little harder. Turn your business.
You know, it's not even just the food menu. It's also the game menu. Because I like want to have like the full game list and like the beer list, and that keeps changing, and I keep switching games around and switching food around.
I just keep hearing excuses. I'm not
yeah.
sure.
So cool. I'm going to show up Friday. Mm-hmm. We'll see what happens by Friday.
Yeah.
Maybe this is all you needed. A little gentle push. A few hoo-gotten.
Or a dick slap. Are you kidding me? You
dick
slap?
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, I'm no Walter Payton.
Yeah,
I'm no Peyton Manning.
I wanted to take a look at your foot.
14s, buddy. 14s.
You want to be careful where that foot goes. All right.
It's Bigfoot. Anyway, Todd.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's it. If you go to tpspproductions.com, you can follow us on Facebook. You can follow us on Twitter. You can follow us on YouTube. You can see us all over the place. We're on iTunes. We're on Stitcher. Please subscribe. Please like us. Please rub one off and think about us. Whatever you got to do to make sure you give us all the attention that we possibly could need. Please hook us up at Twitter at Matt and Todd as well, because we don't ever use it, but it's there. And while you're on our website, you can check out the Bandwagon podcast. You can check out Jackie Live. You can check out the comedy Supernova.
Right.
And coming up, as you heard Matt talk about, there's going to be the Wellraiser Radio.
Wellraiser Radio. Yeah. And?
And
to be determined.
To be determined, Ernie Trout's... Trout's podcast on... self-defense.
You know what? It's politics. It's guns. It's society. It's going to be
Cedar Valley Outfitters.
He has a lot of opinions,
and they're awesome. He's a good he's a good dude. I like him a lot.
I really enjoyed his point of view on a lot of things.
Looking forward to having his own podcast.
Do we have another thing coming out?
I don't also think, no.
By the way, also tpspproductions.com. You'll go there. You'll see TPS Media or TPSP Media. Don't be surprised. Don't be shocked. It's all the same place. If you click on the TPSP Productions tab, you'll see this bald fucker with the eyebrow, and then you'll see Todd, the back of Todd's fat neck, right there.
My girlfriend likes it.
Yeah, she does, doesn't she?
What's wrong with that?
But we also put together high quality, low cost commercials for web based companies. And we are dipping our toes into the audiobook productions aspect. And soon we will be looking for, so keep your eyes and ears peeled. We will be looking for a sales and marketing intern, social media intern. And what was the other one we were looking for?
We're looking for, doesn't your sales, partner marketing. Wants audio actors as well, right? Audiobook actors or something?
Well, voiceover we people. Will be looking for voiceover actors. And if you want a piece of that pie to always and forever be known for that book that you read, whatever, you can contact us at tpspproductions.com. Also, one more thing. If you're interested at all in the Cedar Rapids area and you're trying as an intern to be in the production studio of a live possible video production or podcast, tpspproductions.com. Contact Shane at tpspproductions.com or Simon at tpspproductions.com and let us know if you're at all interested in any of those three positions, because that's what we're trying to fill. That's what I'm trying to fill. I'm trying to find somebody worthy. Is that... Yeah. that decent, worthy.
Good luck with all that. That's all I got to say.
Anyway, that's it for tonight on the Problem Screen podcast. Chris Ellis, thank you, sir, very much for coming on.
Thanks for bringing me back.
Anytime, buddy.
I do want to do a live show from your place. I would love that. Even if it's just audio. It's
kind of fun. Yeah.
Yeah, on a Monday or something that we could just fuck around and
absolutely
check out all your stuff. I would love that. I love it, love it, love it.
Run around the place in circles.
Todd did
pints
that.
Full of beer.
Now he's just getting crazy.
Yeah.
I own the place.
That's it for tonight on the Problem Screen podcast. I'm Matt.
And I'm always Todd.
We'll see you later.
Adios.
Good night.